Greetings. In this video, I will review a list of scriptures which seem to touch on Jesus' return, and they are offered for your consideration, specifically their implication of a rapture. I mentioned the imagery of the bridegroom. Why is that important? The imagery of the bridegroom occurs multiple times in the New Testament, and Jesus establishes the validity of the imagery in this situation. Matthew 9:14. Then the disciples of John came to Jesus inquiring, "Why is it that we and the Pharisees fast often, that is, abstain from food and drink as a religious exercise, but your disciples do not fast?" So this is a specific question about the specific actions of the disciples with Jesus. And Jesus replied to them, "Can the wedding guests mourn while the bridegroom is still with them? The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast." From the previous verse, who is this verse talking about? His disciples. And how does Jesus refer to them in this passage? As the wedding guests, but not as the bride. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. However, the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away, and then they, my disciples, will fast. Jesus has just established that he is the bridegroom, at least in this parable or story. So it is reasonable, but not necessarily absolute, that any mention of a bridegroom means Jesus. But the principle must be honestly considered from an assumption of intellectual consistency. Would it be reasonable to assume each mention of the Comforter refers to a different Comforter? No, it would not. Likewise, Jesus, having established self-referentially that he is the bridegroom, we should respect his concept, his imagery. So that is why the imagery of the bridegroom is important. Now, a quick search for a bridegroom in the New Testament reveals the following references: Matthew 25:1-13, Mark 2:19-20, John 2:9, John 3:28-30, and Revelation 18:23. But I would like to go through these verses in a different order: John 2:9, Revelation 18, John 3, Mark 2, and then finally Matthew 25. John 2:9, "And when the manager tasted the water, just now turned into wine, not knowing where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, he called the bridegroom." This is part of the story in John 2:1-11, of the wedding where Jesus performed his first miracle. I do not believe this reference to bridegroom has any meaning toward the rapture, his coming, or the last days. This reference to bridegroom does not secretly refer to Jesus in any way. Revelation 18:21, "Then a single powerful angel took up a boulder like a great millstone and flung it into the sea, crying, 'With such violence shall Babylon the great city be hurled down to destruction and shall never again be found.'" 22. "And the sound of one, harpists and minstrels and flute players and trumpeters shall never again be heard in you." And 2. "No skilled artisan of any craft shall ever again be found in you." 3. "And the sound of the millstone shall never again be heard in you." "And never again shall 4. "The light of a lamp shine in you." 5. "And the voice of bridegroom and bride shall never be heard in you again. For your businessmen were the great and prominent men of the earth, and by your magic spells and poisonous charm all nations were led astray, seduced and deluded." The context is mentioning Babylon being destroyed at the end. Mention of the bride and bridegroom is one item in a list of 5, which indicate destruction and lack of normalcy. I would hesitate to try and invent a spiritualization that this means Jesus and his bride will never visit Babylon again. I therefore do not believe this reference to bridegroom has any meaning toward the rapture, his coming, John 3:28. You yourselves are my witnesses that I stated I am not the Christ, the Anointed One, the Messiah, but I have only been sent before him, in advance of him to be his appointed forerunner, his messenger, his announcer. This is the Amplified translation. This is John the Baptist speaking. He who has the bride is the bridegroom, but the groomsman who stands by and listens to him rejoices greatly and heartily on account of the bridegroom's voice. This then is my pleasure and joy, and it is now complete. This is part of John's rationale that he is not the bridegroom. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. But some rejoice, the groomsman who stands by. John says, this then is his pleasure, and it is now complete. Prophet John is stating he is a groomsman. Notice this is a second independent confirmation that Jesus is the bridegroom. Mark 2:18. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were observing a fast, and some people came and asked Jesus, why are John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fasting, but your disciples are not doing so? Jesus answered them, can the wedding guests fast, abstain from food and drink, while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, and they will fast in that day. This duplicates the original passage I mentioned from Matthew. Clearly, Jesus identifies himself as the bridegroom. Matthew 25:1-13 remains as holding the revelatory content about the bridegroom. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. The word then is an important connector to the previous passage. I won't dig into Matthew 24 here, but the context is Jesus answering three questions by his disciples. Matthew 24:3, tell us, 1, when will this take place, and 2, what will be the sign of your coming, and 3, of the end, the completion or consummation of the age. This separates two events, 1, his coming, and 2, the end of the age. But by itself, does not speak for or against the rapture. But this is the context of Matthew 25, answering these three questions. And it makes sense Matthew 25:1-11 answers question 2. What will be the sign of your coming? The coming of the bridegroom. I'll tie this in a moment. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. The kingdom of heaven will be likened to. I believe this is critical to notice. All 10 were looking for the bridegroom. To me, this speaks of 10 believers. Are unbelievers looking for Jesus? Or are they mocking his delay? Now, one obvious theory is that all 10 represent Christians. But that carries some sobering and scary implications. Because not all 10 go into the marriage supper with the bridegroom. Let's leave that concept for the moment. A possible alternative theory could be that these 10 represent Christians and Jews. Make no mistake, the Jewish people long for their Messiah. And God's covenant with Abraham is eternal. Jewish people know the cultural significance of the imagery of the bridegroom. Remember, it is the imagery that Jesus used to teach his Jewish disciples. However, I do not think it is a plausible interpretation, Jews and Christians. It also does not possibly account for messianic believers. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. For the foolish, when they took their lamps, they took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Established teaching is that the oil means the Holy Spirit. But I'm going to hold off making that assertion, just like every bridegroom means Jesus. And we've seen that is not always the case. Now, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. All of them. But at midnight there was a cry, "Behold the bridegroom! Come you forth to meet him!" Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Tying it in, here is his coming. All 10 heard the cry. All 10 awoke. And the foolish said unto the wise, "Give us of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "Peradventure there will not be enough for us and you. Go you rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves." And while they went away to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Now, riddle me this. If this does not speak of the rapture, what happens to the 5 foolish virgins? Is this parallel to the other people who cried, "Lord, Lord," and Jesus rebuffed with, "I never knew you"? Matthew 7:23, "And then will I declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, lawlessness." Jesus tells these, "I never knew you." Then Jesus tells them, "Depart from me." I don't know about you, but those words, "depart from me," are scary. Jesus uses them elsewhere, and it's not a happy time. Matthew 25:41, "Then he will say to those on his left, Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." "Depart from me" is not what I want to hear Jesus say to me. I'm pretty sure it does not mean you get a timeout until I let you into heaven in 30 minutes. So one analysis that allows for the rapture says Jesus comes early to receive his bride to be with him, and they enter the marriage supper. But if this is not speaking of the rapture, of Jesus coming early to receive his bride and be with him and enter the marriage supper, what happens to the 5 foolish virgins? I suspect that aspect of the non-rapture interpretation has never been given much thought. But the obvious interpretation is that the 5 foolish perish, meaning hell. Now, a perfectly fair question is, in the rapture scenario, what happens to the 5 foolish virgins? They go through the events, the tribulations coming to pass on the earth. There's one other passage I've never heard addressed much in church, which you have to consider. Luke 21:36, "But keep on the alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are about to take place, and to stand before the Son of Man." Escape is different than survive. King James reads, "that you may be accounted worthy to escape." The Aramaic Bible in plain English reads, "you will be worthy to escape." Whether worthy or strong enough, there are clearly 2 paths. One path escapes, the other path goes through the events. And Jesus suggests we pray to achieve one path over the other. But keep on the alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are about to take place. Clearly, traveling one path is preferential to the other. And the implication is we contribute to the determination of the path we travel. Or else Jesus is telling us to pray a failed prayer he knows he will never answer. Please give that serious, honest consideration. These are Jesus's words, not mine. For me, the more I considered Jesus's teaching on the bridegroom and the 10 virgins, the more the non-rapture scenario just did not make sense, could not answer meaningful questions. In the next video, I will cover additional scriptures which have infused my thinking on the subject of the rapture. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.